welcome you to the second Provost Lecture Series. We're pleased to have Dr. Pietrobon here, more about him. The concept around the Provost Lecture Series is, you know, we will have the opportunity to learn from experts who have experiences that may be relevant to our mission and our activities here, particularly as we seek to advance our institution as regards academic medicine and academic duty. Today, I'm particularly excited because I think we're going to hear a bit about big data, and in particular how big data, which was originally coined as the three Vs, volume, velocity, and variety, will impact what we do here at UTMB. It's the way of thinking about how we store and manipulate data, and I think it's critically important as we collaborate across the whole institution, as we will begin to have access to vast amounts of data and can use that to transform how we care for patients, but also how we pursue biomedical research. So Dr. Pietrobon is actually an expert in that area. I think, knows than anyone I've ever met about how data processes can be streamlined so that instead of having just data elements, we actually have information. He's chief executive officer of SporeData Incorporated, a startup company that provides high-quality statistical analyses and methodologies for clinical research data while ensuring compliance with industry, government, and academic standards. I'd like to share a few historical details about Dr. Pietrobon's journey, and it might, we'll find some more chairs, sorry folks, it might get a little long, but I'll try to summarize. He received his medical degree from his homeland of Brazil. He then, in 2004, completed his PhD in epidemiology from the University of North Carolina. During that last year of his PhD degree, he achieved additional certification around information design from Ohio State. 2 years later, he completed his Master's of Business Administration from the Fuqua School. In addition to his degree work, he's had what I would call multiple advantage positions, including completing his residency training in orthopedic surgery, then becoming director of outcomes research for sports medicine and ambulatory surgery at Duke. Ultimately, he was moved on up, as we say, and was appointed director of biomedical informatics for Duke's Translational Medicine Institute. You know, one of the concepts I have about the Provost Lecture Series is that we want to make sure we invite people who are productively or positively disruptive. Folks can help us think differently about what we do, and I think that's one of the things that's most admirable about Dr. Pietrobon. One of the things that we worked on in earlier life was his work. What he taught me was, you know, we need to do research on research to understand how to improve our processes, and that was instrumental to some of the successes in other institutions. He's had published more than 275 peer-reviewed publications. He's associate editor for the Journal of Manual and Manipulative Therapy. He's a reviewer for many other journals. He's associate editor for a major research journal in Brazil. And importantly, he's currently an active reviewer for the CTSA and PCORI programs. What I hope we will learn, I'm sure we will, is that regardless of all these wonderful accomplishments, he can help us think about how we can better forge collaborations and friendships across our academic medical center. So, Dr. Pietrobon, delighted to have you here. Come on in. I'm sorry, we got to find some more chairs, but close the door, close the house.
Well, thank you very much for the invitation. It's a real pleasure to be here. This is my first time in Galveston, and I'm absolutely amazed. You know, you guys live in a paradise, and I'm so jealous. A little bit about what I'm going to be talking about. This is the outline. So I'm going to be talking about, you know, the traditional path, so the different tracks. Today I learned that when at Duke, you know, we used to talk about the four different missions, so clinical, research, education, and administration. So today I learned that usually administration here, at least, it's not considered to be one of the missions. I am going to include administration in my talk, and I hope this will become clear later. And then I'm going to argue that, you know, times are changing. You know, we're going through a major shift right now in terms of government, in terms of healthcare, and in terms of research. The next, I don't know, 5 to 10 years, I think the scenario is going to change completely. And I'm going to try to use my crystal ball here to make some predictions. I'll give an example of something that we're doing at this point, trying to align with these modifications, that we call the Cost, Quality, and Operations Consortium. And then I'll talk a little bit about how to get this done. A bit about me, Dr. Jacobs, already mentioned something. So I'm an orthopedic surgeon, got my PhD and MBA. I'm today with what people, back in the day, 10 years ago, people would ask what I do, and I was like, well, I'm not really sure. Today, they came up with this thing called a data scientist. So now it became easier for me. So I'm a data scientist. I was an associate professor of surgery at Duke with Dr. Jacobs. As he mentioned, I was the director of the biomedical informatics for the Duke CTSA. Currently, I'm the CEO for SporeData. Later on, I'll talk more about this. Even though I'm no longer a formal faculty member at any institution, I still keep up with a few things. So I'm a reviewer for the CTSA, for the PCORI, and I'm an adjunct professor at a few universities around the country. Okay, so let's get to this. So the traditional path. So the missions, as I said, usually, what we consider to be missions are, okay, I'm a clinician. What do? I treat patients, and I read papers sometimes. Researcher, we publish papers. Administrators, we deal with people and costs. Educator, books and tests. I'm oversimplifying. But basically, by and large, these four missions are almost completely separate. If you're an administrator, basically, you don't do research. If you're a researcher, you can be a clinician, but your primary activity is to be a researcher, so on and so forth. Now, does this work? Well, it works. We'll continue to have people in different paths, but I think, we're getting a new trend now where we're going to be trying to do to bring together all four missions. And I'll give you some examples of how this can be done. So what are the trends? Why is this changing? Why are we undergoing all of these modifications? So at this point, and this is happening currently here, we're having access to an amount of data that is absolutely unprecedented. So UTMB is on that path. And currently, we have clinical data, we have cost data, we're putting together data warehouses that combine biobanks, operational data. We have information about our ORs, our ICUs, our emergency rooms, and social determinants of health. So basically, we know more today about what happens to patients after they leave the hospital than we have ever done. Now, are we using all of that information to provide better care to our patients, do better research, educate the next generation of clinical researchers, and do a better job in terms of administration? Well, not quite. We still have a long way to go. This is just one example of something that we're currently implementing in some a few centers around the country. This is basically just an interface of it's a generic name for a program called BI or Business Intelligence. So basically, what we're doing now is that we're getting some of that data and presenting them to administrators so that they can make better decisions in terms of day-to-day operations within the hospital. We're providing this to residents and fellows so that they can start generating better research questions and build their careers, potentially join the faculty members. And also, of course, to provide better prediction and provide decision support for clinicians. So the interesting thing is that you have one single source, a mega source of data, but providing input to several different missions at the same time. So other changes, value-based care delivery. So this is an alphabet soup, and we're getting hit by this day and night. MACRA. So what is this? Basically, we're going to get paid based on the quality provided to our patients. We're going to get paid depending on how sophisticated our data collection systems are, primarily the electronic health record. How much clinical improvement can we get to our patients? And how can we achieve better quality or at least the same quality at the same cost. Now, none of these things can be done unless you have an underlying, fairly strong data infrastructure. So more and more, we're going to be relying not on gut feelings, but we're going to be relying on data. Other things, payment bundles. Everybody's, you know, is currently aware of this at this point. We, at this point, we are responsible for patients not only while they are in the hospital, but basically up to 90 days. If any complication happens, the patient will come back to us, and we're going to be in charge of providing care to that patient, basically using the same amount of funding. So every single decision at this point, in terms of whether patients should have surgery, whether they should have treatment A versus treatment B, is not going to rely only in terms of what kind of information we have within the hospital. We're going to be relying on information about where are these patients going. So if I do a total hip replacement on a patient and this patient goes back to a facility that where he or she doesn't have the medication or doesn't have the food or doesn't have the appropriate conditions to be cared for and a complication happens, that's on me. So we have to have data systems to be able to make those kinds of predictions. In addition, insurance negotiations. Dr. Jacobs led some efforts at Duke, which, and he, you know, he was way ahead of the curve there. But today, negotiations in terms of better reimbursement or making a referral center out of your clinical practice all rely on the outcomes that you can generate out of those patients. If you don't have data to demonstrate that you're doing a good job, especially a better job compared to other practices, you're going to be receiving less funding. And finally, risk sharing models. This is something that's just beginning now, but very likely the next 5 to 10 years, we're going to be negotiating with all kinds of providers, HMOs, pharma companies, device companies, where if they can provide us with better outcomes for our patients, we're going to be doing profit sharing. Now, unless we have very good data to understand exactly what kinds of improvements we can get with those kinds of devices or drugs, it's going to be bad business for us. So everything goes back to data. In data sets are absolutely essential to the practice of medicine across all four missions. So this is just one example. This is actually one of the analyses that we're doing in one of the centers collaborating with us. This is information about expenditures, and I'm looking at this from a health systems perspective, okay? And what we found is that patients without depression, their expenditures for the same condition are all the way down. If you have patients who have depression and are symptomatic, this is the upper curve here, and their expenditures are way up. If a patient has a diagnosis of depression without symptoms or has symptoms without a diagnosis of depression, their cost is going to be right in the middle. And basically, these two or these three groups here are a big opportunity. Why? Because if we were doing a better job in terms of treating these patients, expenditures would be lower. Now, this has direct implications for healthcare systems, because if we can demonstrate that by treating depression in these clinics and reducing expenditures, HMOs, insurance companies, are absolutely interested in negotiating with us. So basically, they can either increase our reimbursement rates or they can make us a referral center. Now, none of this happens unless you have a good data quality system, unless you have data that you can draw conclusions for and present to them. Community and patient-centered research. You know, we talked about PCORI before. Standards in terms of research today are completely related to having patients participating in every single step of the way. Before, we used to basically get patients into our studies. Now, this has been changing completely. Patients are now part of the design of the study, they are part of the data collection of the study, they are part of the analysis of the study, and they are part of the dissemination of these results. PCORI has released a number of different methodological standards where they define exactly how we should be doing research. Now, in order for all of this to happen, we need to be able to track cohorts of patients over time. There was a recent paper in the New England Journal of Medicine published in July of 2016. This paper is basically a landmark. What they are doing is that they are keeping using institutional data to create a cohort of patients, and rather than doing the traditional trial infrastructure where you do one trial, you close that trial, you go to the next trial, and then you keep going. You keep one single cohort of patients, and then basically you keep adapting that trial and introducing new therapies one every 6 months or 8 months. That reduces the cost of implementing randomized controlled trials, and it basically brings clinical trials right to your practice. So again, there's a complete merge between the care that you're providing to your patients and the research that you're doing with those same patients. Now, how does this get done? Only if you have the ability to start tracking data for every single patient within your institution. So data is absolutely essential. Finally, patient-reported outcome measures. There's a number of initiatives around the country. I think University of Pennsylvania and Minnesota are probably the leaders at this point. Basically using patient-reported outcomes for every single patient within a given clinic. Now, why are they doing this? Primarily for two reasons. Medical decision-making. So if a given treatment is able to improve quality of life, that treatment should be used. Number two, again, negotiations with insurance companies. Unless you can demonstrate that your patients are doing better, insurance companies are not going to be paying for certain treatments. So this is being done on a regular basis using technologies such as computerized adaptive testing, which is a way of shortening the amount of time that a patient spends doing this type of evaluation. Oops. So this is just one example of a kind of report that's generated in real time. So basically, you're seeing the patient, and you can get in real time an evaluation of how that patient is doing. Usually, you would have a report like this over time. So is my patient getting better? Is my patient getting worse? And this type of information can be used for, again, negotiations with insurance companies. And then finally, training the next generation of clinical and translational researchers. Back in the day, we used to believe that whatever procedure we were doing in the OR, it doesn't matter. If I have a better technology, I should be using that technology. Well, this is no longer the truth. Today, unless we can demonstrate that something is indeed better, nobody's going to pay for that. So cost-conscious professionals. In several of these institutions where we're working right now, not only residents and fellows, they will participate in research publications related to cost and quality, but it's perceived that their education in terms of how much it costs to deliver care is part of their training. So it's no longer just about indicating a certain procedure and being able to perform that procedure. They have to be cost conscious. Okay, so now this is just one example of how this can be implemented in practice. And this is what we call the Cost, Quality, and Operations Consortium. And the idea is basically to unify the missions. So it's a group of academic institutions and private hospitals. And basically what we're doing is that we're collecting data, existing data, from each one of these institutions in these four constructs or realms. Cost, operations, quality. So in terms of quality, is everybody here familiar with Vizient or UHC? So, yeah. So 95% of all institutions around the country currently provide cost data to UHC. Two and a half years ago, UHC was actually purchased for by a for-profit company called Vizient. It's member-owned, so it's not like, you know, you're giving your data to somebody else. So you are still the owner of your data set. But basically what you do is that you provide them with charge data. They do a cost-to-charge transformation, and they have web applications that allow you to compare yourself versus others. So for example, if I go today to, whatever, the University of Maryland, I can look up costs from UTMB in buckets, so at the aggregate level. So at this point, I have access to your cost data in a way. It's completely focused on finances. They have no operations, but their research is possible but not trivial. It's actually a fairly complicated system. What we're doing with the consortium is that we're using exactly the same type of data, but we're aggregating patient-level data across multiple institutions. And I'll give you a few examples of the kinds of things that we can do with that data. Number two, this consortium, this is just an interface for Vizient. Number two, we're capturing pre-existing data on operations, basically timestamp data with DRGs for OR, ER, ICU, anything that might involve workflow. For example, to study reduction in turnover time. So basically, we evaluate flow over time. We try to decrease variation. And number three, quality. Now, quality is very variable across institutions. For some institutions, it's only going to be about complication rates and readmissions. In other places, such as, for example, the state of Maryland, so University of Maryland, MedStar, and Johns Hopkins, they're combining different data sets. So for example, CRISP is a database within the state of Maryland that allows you to track every single patient across the entire state using a single identifier. So basically, today we were having a conversation about patients who leave without being seen from the ED. Up to this point, you know, we were absolutely unsure about what was happening with those patients. With this kind of database, I can not only track them across the entire state, but I have somewhere around 1,500 variables about each one of their encounters, so every single possible piece of information. We're combining that data with Epic data, census data. Again, bear in mind, with bundles, at this point, we're in charge of whatever happens to patients after they leave the hospital. So I want to be aware. I need to know exactly what's going to happen to them. And then AHA. AHA is American Hospital Association, somewhere around 1,500 variables about every single aspect of systems, staff. There's a third component that I'm blanking on, about the hospital, okay? So with databases like this, we can basically have track the history of a patient. I think they started in 2013, all the way to now. And by that, I literally mean like a month ago. Adverse drug events and dosing, we're tracking this across the board. As I mentioned, some of the universities we're working with, they are collecting PROMs, so patient-reported outcomes. And with the visit schedule optimization with data such as ER, OR, and ICU. So what do we do with this? I'm going to show you a mock calculator. Let's see if this shows up. Basically, what this thing allows you to do, once you have these fairly powerful data sets, you can start generating literally calculators for quality and cost. So I can get information about baseline or whatever happened with a patient within a given admission, and then try to predict exactly what's going to happen with those patients over time. Now, the reason why this is so important, and I could run some models here for you, but it's basically just a calculator. I won't go much into this. So basically, you know, it will give me a calculation of what's going to happen with them. I don't have cost here, but cost could be one of those components. So why is this so important? So let's go back to the four missions. Of course, you know, this is research. And this is probably one of the most important things that we're going to be doing in terms of research over the next 10 years. Some of these databases, we're using text mining or natural language processing to extract information from surgical reports, all kinds of free text within Epic, to generate variables to predict outcomes and cost. So it's research. Number two, I would argue that this can improve quality of care. So one initiative that we have at this point with Brigham, they were questioning whether the follow-up for patients having joint replacement, do we really need to have patients coming back every 3 months? So usually for a regular joint replacement patient, you will have a series of visits right after the surgical procedure, then with 3 months, 6 months, 1 year, and then 1 year after that. Now with these kinds of calculators, we can calculate exactly what's the likelihood of somebody having a complication with that within the next 3 months. If their rates of complication are fairly low, what we can say is, here's my card, you can go home, and if you have something, call me. But the reality is, if your likelihood of having a complication is 2% or 3%, the patient doesn't want to come back to the hospital. And probably I don't want to see that patient because, you know, my time could be better used taking care of other patients in more need than I am. Now, from a company perspective or from an administrative perspective, I can start running models that will tell me what's the best way of spending my dollars in the hospital. So I don't necessarily have to use money unless it's absolutely necessary. From a company perspective, so let's say a device company. Again, my examples will usually be in orthopedics. Let's say that there's a new shoulder replacement device. And this shoulder replacement device can reduce, and this is actually a true case, can reduce the time in the OR in 20 minutes, can reduce the risk of complications for a patient undergoing a shoulder arthroplasty in, I believe the rate is somewhere around 10%. Now, whenever a company comes to the hospital and tries to sell that device for $100 more, usually the purchasing department is going to be is going to use a very simple algorithm. If it's more expensive, I don't want it. Why are we doing this? Well, primarily because, you know, that's where the incentives are. It's not their fault. At this point, we don't have mechanisms to translate potential clinical improvements into dollars. With something like this, not this specific model, but I could potentially input here that we're going to save 20 minutes in the OR, and on average, the risk of complications is going to go down by, say, 5%. And I can get a more or less accurate prediction in terms of what the cost savings are. So this change, you know, the way we operate it fairly differently. So basically this concept. So translated from quality to dollars and back. Now this is interesting because this all of a sudden, you know, it starts connecting administrators and clinicians closely. You know, we constantly. I heard a story. 3 weeks ago, I was at the meeting for the American Academy of Orthopedic Surgeons, and there was a surgeon telling me the following story: that the purchasing department. And listen, I'm not picking on purchasing departments. You know, it's just the way the system is set at this point. So they had decided that purchasing a given device that costs $10 less, and I'm not kidding, $10 less, was more cost efficient. The problem is it was a device used for arthroscopy and the system was clogging every single time. So basically the surgeon was spending an average of 15 to 20 minutes in the OR more because of this device. Now the time, this is, you know, I'm just doing the calculation that, you know, a calculator would do. The time in the OR on average varies anywhere from $45 to $120. So there are different estimates. So if you have, even if you take the 45 and you multiply that by 15 or 20, you would have to, you know, do a huge number of procedures. And consider that you would only have one device clogging. So it makes no sense whatsoever. But today, because we don't have mechanisms to translate potential clinical advantages into dollar figures, the system is completely upside down. Now, back in the day, this was acceptable because, you know, we had money to spend. This is no longer going to be the case. With new administration, with, you know, the value-based healthcare model, this is no longer going to be acceptable. We're going to be out of business. Now, how does this consortium actually get funded? And this is one of the interesting things because, you know, I only had a few meetings today, but it seems like, you know, one of the constant topics is how do we incentivize our junior faculty members to potentially quickly be able to buy time to conduct their research. So the expression I kept hearing was like, you know, this is a chicken egg problem, right? So if you don't give them time, they're not going to be researchers. But if they don't have research, well, basically, you know, they cannot be researchers. So it's a big problem. A mechanism like this, I think, you know, we've been, and I don't want to oversell this, but it has been pretty interesting because, number one, we're not doing data collection. So it's an easy way into a clinical research career. Number two, as you know, from my previous example in terms of the calculation, you can probably tell this is a fairly appealing thing for a number of different entities. So pharma and device companies, well, basically they are all over this. During the AAOS, this was actually surprising to me. You know, I was talking with a couple people at J&J, and this is not a joke, this is actually true. Within 20 minutes, they were calling the president for US J&J to come talk to me about this system. I was like, oh, really? So this is of interest to them because this will allow them to establish a layer of communication with hospitals, which at this point they don't have. HMOs, the example from diabetes, they are interested in reducing their costs. We are interested in improving quality of care for our patients. So all of a sudden, you start realizing that, you know, we're not enemies. You know, we're not competing. We're actually looking for the same thing, probably from different angles. And this kind of research actually allows you to align these different people. CTSA and PCORI. So I actually happen to be a reviewer for both mechanisms. There's one word that will come up every single time whenever we're reviewing proposals, and it is collaboration. So this type of consortium where you're basically sharing data that you were already sharing anyway, you know, you're already providing cost data to other institutions, and everybody can look at your data. I can look at your data. You allowed other institutions to look at your data. But all of a sudden, if you start aggregating patient-level data, basically you have an advantage. So your proposals would be much stronger. Government contracts, and even institutional. So we have a few examples now where the institution is providing funding to researchers because their research is actually leveraging their ability to do better administration. So there are multiple sources of funding, and this usually will primarily benefit junior faculty members. Now, how to get it done? And you know, a few project examples. So, to participate in a consortium like this, you know, pretty easy. Usually, what we do is that we do an inventory of databases, and you have an outstanding data warehouse here. You know, it would be a pretty simple mission, and you start doing funding attraction almost immediately. So you start seeking funding, and you start bringing funding to the institution. And then data modeling and governance. So who's going to have access to the data? You know, what kinds of models are we going to be using? So types of projects. I gave a few examples before. But for example, optimizing OR turnover time. The OR time is, without a question, the single most expensive place in the entire institution. You know, it's hard to beat $100 an hour. Natural language processing to start taking unstructured text, so surgical notes, ICU notes, discharge notes, and turning that into variables that you can use for your predictive models. Again, flow and time evaluation. This is just an example. Actually, it's not a real example. This is basically what natural language processing does. You create some algorithms and you identify chunks of information that you can then transform into variables. And I can manipulate this in regular models, in prediction models. integration across databases. I gave the example of, you know, what we're doing in Maryland. So combining databases, different databases, your Epic database with state databases, with census in American Hospital Association. This is just one example. So we were basically mapping, patients who left without being seen across different regions. This is a macro map. We can get really detailed. Educating residents and fellows. This is a very important component. Whenever you have a system like this, getting research done is easy. So you can immediately, you know, bring that into your portfolio to attract the best residents, to attract the best fellows. And I didn't add it here, but to attract, to be able to attract the best junior faculty members, to be competitive in this market. Having a structure like this, you know, it's, I'm not going to say it's a plug and play, but it becomes fairly easy for them to come in and come in fairly productive. And again, as I mentioned before, you know, making them cost conscious. We're in a different environment at this point. Again, this is the tableau. This is something that we're using for residents and fellows to generate their own research questions. Leveraging negotiations with insurance companies. Again, improving reimbursement. We can go to them and say, hey, we have the best care in the area. Can we improve our reimbursement rates? Can we refer more patients to us in a given specialty for a given procedure? In marketing. Now, this is essential. At this point, you know, most of the marketing efforts across the nation are about, hey, come to us, we're good. Well, patients are far more educated in terms of data today than they were 5 or 10 years ago. Whenever I have to have a procedure, and especially if it's a complex procedure, I'll do an extensive search on the web. And if a given institution can give me some data, again, we're not talking about complicated things. So it has to be at the patient level, at the level that a layperson would understand. But if we can provide them with data and information to demonstrate that we're better than the competition, you're going to be able to attract more patients. So multiple missions. So in conclusion, what's the punchline? Data sets should permeate all of our decisions. I think this is the mantra definitely for the next 5 years, 5 to 10 years. It's not only about data, but it's about building decision support models. It's no longer just about writing papers. It's about creating web applications, creating something that you can access from your cell phone that will help you treating patients at bedside. And then, very important, I think at least in this specific area, the four missions are, you know, they are coming together. So we can generate papers, we can build careers of our junior faculty members, you know, we can lead them towards tenure, we can at the same time improve quality of care, we can make our administrative decisions better, our marketing decisions better, and we can educate the next generation of you know, residents, fellows, and other people doing research in healthcare. So that's the main message. Thank you.
Stay up. I think we have time for a few questions. Okay. And may I start off?
Yes.
So here's one of those questions that I think you and I used to periodically talk about. And so how does this structure and these concepts that you presented relate to the utility or lack thereof of the future as regards randomized controlled
trials? Oh, very important.
Yeah.
So let me start by saying this. In 2000 and it's either 11 or 12, there was a researcher from UCLA called Pearl. Pearl has demonstrated that you can use observational data to, this is the technical pitch, and then I'll come back to this. You can use observational data to draw conclusions that are equivalent to randomized controlled trials. He won the Turing Award, which is the equivalent of the Nobel Prize in computer sciences. So basically what he's saying and what he has demonstrated is that if you have good quality data, you can use very large databases like this to draw conclusions that will be almost identical
to what you would get conducting a randomized controlled trial, but with one advantage. You're getting real-world data. Okay. Now, am I saying that, you know, randomized trials are done? Absolutely not. There's a number of situations, a number of research questions where these methods would not be applicable, and I won't get into the technical details. Now, so that answers part of the question. Now, the second part of the question is actually that paper from New England Journal. This is a new trend. CTSA is absolutely all over this, and this is called Bayesian adaptive trials. So again, the traditional way of doing a trial is this. I come up with a question, I go through a nightmare with the IRB, I have huge costs, I sweat blood, I get my trial done, I'm always behind my schedule, and then I close the trial. I want to do a second one, guess what? I'll start the process all over again. What Bayesian adaptive trials bring to the table is that you can keep one cohort, and this is basically what that New England Journal of Medicine did, that paper did. You keep one single cohort, and then you keep introducing new therapies over time. So basically, this is one single setup, which means that you will have the ability to predict exactly what your recruitment rate is going to be, because all the sites are the same, all of your staff is already trained. And then what you do is that you keep introducing new therapies over time. Now, where do Bayesian adaptive trials intersect with this concept? I think that this concept will allow you to generate your control groups. So basically, you can use some of that data, not only to collect data on a group of patients that you're following over time, but you can use administrative data to enhance the trials that you're conducting. Actually, Rob Califf he had an article in the Fortune magazine a couple months ago where he was basically referring to this. So I think, you know, both concepts are going to be occurring at the same time. So on one side, deriving randomized information from observational data, from the other side, using this kind of data set to create your cohort for adaptive randomized trials.
Thank you very much. Questions from the audience?
Fascinating. So my question is, your modeling for prediction is rather simplistic, if I'm
saying. Yeah.
Because this is, for surgical procedures and elective procedures, that may be quite applicable. But what about patients who have myriad of comorbidities and medical issues? I think it becomes quite complex to predict even their outcomes, readmissions, or cost. So I'd like to hear your thoughts.
Absolutely. So, of course, my example here was fairly simplistic on purpose. I wouldn't place a huge model. But I think at first, absolutely, comorbidities, and even in certain situations, so pediatric cases, where comorbidities don't play such a big of a role, in order to do risk adjustment, you have to have much more granular information about their conditions. Just as one example, we're currently working with a group treating osteochondral lesions. I know my examples are all in orthopedics, but this is just because it's easier for me. Okay. I'm an orthopedic surgeon, so give me a break. They don't have comorbidities. So basically, primarily, the prediction of outcomes is related to the lesion itself. With this type of technology, especially the natural language processing, you can get more accurate data without necessarily collecting the entire data in discrete variables. So this is not a silver bullet. It's not going to solve everything. I showed a fairly simple example, but one of the interesting things about these models is that depending on the type of validation that you do, you can have a pretty good estimate of how accurate your models are going to be. So, if at one point we generate a model and we say, okay, this is bad, we're probably better off guessing than using the model. Well, basically, we don't use the model. Then we need better data, and that's not a good use case for that specific thing.
So you're suggesting that we validate the model?
Oh. So there's a saying in predictive modeling, which is, it's not about the model, it's about the modeling process. So the way you model is much more important than, so by just demonstrating this to you, you should not trust me. Actually, that's a mock data set. But unless you know exactly how I perform the validation for the model, that model is absolutely useless. The FDA has had some conversations, and I don't know in which direction they're going to go now, that they're going to start regulating how models are performed. Because by the time we start using these models, you know, on a regular basis to make clinical decisions, then we're affecting, you know, basically the quality of life, maybe even the life of our patients. So it's about the modeling, not about the model. But again, it's not a silver bullet. Every case has to be evaluated fairly carefully.
Thank you. I'm so glad you mentioned that there are other ways to do research than randomized clinical trials. And we should be incorporating research into our daily clinical practice, not just consenting patients, and if they don't consent, then they're not in research. But there are ways to do it while doing everyday clinical practice, including, you didn't mention, but including cluster randomization,
absolutely,
pragmatic trials where, I mean, I use a certain antibiotic, another faculty in my division uses a different antibiotic. You can do that research. However, that requires an institutional review board that knows that the traditional ways of reviewing this research doesn't apply.
Absolutely. So I think that, you know, from an IRB perspective, we had this conversation in the morning. Again, this is a complicated issue. Traditionally, the rule, so let me go back. The CTSA, whenever we're reviewing proposals, we have two sections. One is for biostatistics, and the other one is for regulatory. Usually, these are two separate things. The current trend is that biostatistics and regulatory, the regulatory sections, they should be more and more merged. What are we talking about? Basically, the idea is, sure, the role of the IRB is to protect patients, is to decrease the risk. But you cannot make those evaluations unless you have expertise from a content perspective. Now, how do we address this? This is complicated, because usually the best experts, you know, they have less time and they're fairly expensive. But as we progress, I completely agree with you. I think that the way we review our proposals, you know, will have to be changed. In some way, shape, or form, we'll have to create incentives across the institution so that experts, content experts, and methodological experts can look at the, can review protocols within the IRB and basically, you know, I don't want to say not get in the way. I was a reviewer for the IRB at Duke for 4 years or so. So I understand their side. But right now, it's, you know, far from an ideal system. So I completely agree.
If you're going to be able to substitute longitudinal studies for randomized trials, which is what I heard you say, don't you have to have an awesome number of people that you're plugging into this? You can't do N of ones, obviously,
yeah,
but you need N's of tens of 20,000. What's the order of magnitude of the power that you have when you're trying to substitute one for the classical?
Good question. So before, let me just make a point that you know, I don't want to be misleading here. The work by Pearl, this professor from UCLA, what he said is that under certain circumstances, observational studies can be used to replace, or at least to mimic, the same conclusions that you get from a randomized trial, with the advantage that you're getting real-world data, which is the big problem with randomized trials. These patients are completely different from patients in our practice. Now, the more, the better. The more patients you have, the better. You know, the sample size will vary depending on your question. But the key thing, and again, this is a fairly, you know, it has to do with a number of different technical details. But the most important thing, sample size is important. definitely important. But after a certain level, it probably doesn't matter much. The most important thing, whenever you're trying to transform observational data into to give you randomized conclusions, is that the variables that you have collected account for the, and this is a technical thing, the confounding effect between the intervention and the outcomes. So for example, if I believe that, whatever, education is a fairly important point affecting the relationship between my therapy and the outcome, then I will have to have very good information about education. And this is just a made-up example. So I think sample size will be important, but usually for these types of data sets, we have plenty of patients, which is good. We need the more, the better, always. But it's primarily about our ability to control for confounding. This gets into a much more complicated thing, which is the big advantage of randomized trials is that you can account for confounding of measured and unmeasured variables. Let's say that I conduct a study today and I get to a conclusion that treatment A is better than treatment B. If in 20 years from now people find that there's a gene that affected my outcome, I don't care. Because when I randomized, half of my patients had the gene, the other half didn't have the gene, even though I didn't know anything about the gene. Simply by randomizing them, I get a balance. Again, this is technical stuff. But sample size is important. The most important thing is to be able to account for variables that can affect the treatment.
Any other questions? None? Thank you very much.
UTMB Health, working together to work wonders.